decided that it was going to be with shepherds, didn't he? The lowest of lows and a little stable. And it wasn't until about a year later when the wise men showed up. They say that, we know that because scripture says, you know, when the wise men came, they came to the house. And it's like, wait a second, I remember being a child and saying, wait, hold on. Are you telling me that those guys showed up a year later? I couldn't believe it. But the sign of the star was in the sky. So there's fireworks, and there were shepherds. It was a cozy little greeting and gathering on that first Christmas morning. We're continuing in our little sermon series, The Gifts of Christmas. Last week we talked on a heavy subject, the gift of life. And if you haven't seen that, check that out on our website and watch that. That's a pretty intense, I haven't received any hate mail, it's a pretty intense subject. On choosing life and being pro-life, both for babies and for mothers and for people of different points of view. And so this morning we're going a little lighter. We're talking about the subject of gold. Gold. What a subject. You know, when I think of kings, when I think of King Solomon, I think of, you know, I think of gold. Anyone watch the old movie, Alan Quatermain in King Solomon's Mines? Anyone read the book or watch the show? What a hoot that movie was. Anyways, when I think of kings, I think of gold. I think of this, the richness, the power and authority that goes with it. I think of this element of gold. Let's go to our next slide here. This is, the other thing we thought of was Mr. T. If you don't know the story of Mr. T, I wouldn't say the frying pan, the big bowl thing there, but when he was a bouncer, they said that he would take jewelry from anybody he kicked out of a bar. That was a symbol of his strength. You know, what's a king without gold? That's what they would say. But we know that the baby Jesus showed up in the manger without anything except for love from mom and dad, a safe and secure place. It was a lowly entry into the world, and yet God knew what he was doing. When the wise men showed up with the gold, you know, I got thinking about, okay, who trusted these wise men with gold? You know, how easy, these guys are smart. And there's a difference between being wise and cunning, and it's very different than being manipulative and deceitful and sneaky. These guys had earned enough trust, at least from their wives, to go with gold, right? Somebody empowered them to go and deliver the goods, to deliver the gold. Who was it? We don't know for sure, but we know that in the eastern part of the world, there was a strong astronomy section, and books like Daniel, books like Isaiah, would have been available. Because, you know, we don't think too much about Daniel and his imprisonment, but his name was Belshazzar. And they said there was no one of his equal. He understood all of it. All the astrology, all the astronomy, he knew it all. And there was none like Daniel in equal. He understood dreams, understood visions. And so he would have been he would have had a clout in that realm. And so when these people from the east, the wise men from the east, they would have probably had access to Daniel's writings because they were ancient. But they had been proven time and time again. And so when they saw the star in the sky, the birth of the king, they knew something was up. Matthew 2:2, when they met Herod, they said, "Where is the one who has been born king of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." See, already they knew something was up. And they knew he was more than just a king, because no one says, "I'm going to go worship the king." You know, we might call Mel Norton our honor or our worship. But, you know, we don't come to worship at his feet if we go to city council. Right? No. Even our prime minister or judges, we don't worship them. But they came to worship the king because they knew this was something special. This whole thing was an act of faith. They recognized something precious was going on that was deserving of gold. Of gold. You know, we look at gold in Jesus' life, and we recognize that there's a big difference between Jesus and the Pharisees. And one of those differences is Luke 16:14. It says, the Pharisees loved money. We know that Jesus didn't love money. He wasn't controlled by gold. We don't know exactly what happened with the gold that the wise men gave to Joseph and Mary, but we might touch that in a few minutes here. But we know Jesus, once when one approached about paying the temple tax, he said to Peter, he said, Peter, I want you to go and find me a fish. Of course, first of all, he said to Peter, he said, you know, who pays taxes? The king's sons or his servants? Well, servants, not his sons. And so Jesus said, well, I'm the son of God. I don't really have to pay the tax, but lest I offend someone, Peter, go in and go do some fishing. What did Peter find in the fish, in the mouth of the fish? Does anyone remember?
Money.
He found a coin. I'm very glad that Jesus did it that way, because it says to me several things. He wasn't into counterfeiting money. Which would be more difficult, to recreate bread and fish to feed 10,000, or to create one single element, just a flat coin? Well, I'm telling you, it'd be much more difficult to recreate bread and fish, because it's multiple elements. One is alive, and it's much more intricate. Gold is just a slab of one little element. And so Jesus is not into counterfeiting, but I'll tell you, if he needed to, he could have commanded an army of fish with coins to come up. Jesus wasn't dependent on money for his authority, but when he needed it, he certainly could call it. I used to laugh. Dr. Buckingham was the pastor, senior pastor at the Monthly Blessing. He used to say, you know, we need to get people saved. And he said, you know what? He says, part of the reason we need to get them saved is for our church needs. I was like, what do you mean? He says, well, you know, so there's money in the mouths of those fishes. He's so cool. He's a cool guy. Anyhow, today we need to take a little lesson from Jesus in this fact that if we know that Jesus could call a fish to be caught by Peter and the money in it, you know, we're just praying about this mountain. You know, how can we call ourselves a people of faith if we're never put in a situation where our faith is put to the test? You know, it's part of our training as a church. As God mobilizes us, there has to be mountains, there has to be trials, there has to be things where God gets to prick our heart and say, do you trust me?
Yeah.
Is this mountain too full? Okay, you made it through the last couple years. What if we're in debt like $10,000 more? Are you still going to trust me?
Mm.
Right? Well, yeah. Of course we are. Of course we're going to trust him. Whose church is this anyways?
God's.
It's ours and his, right? It's been both. It does belong. The fact that the church has existed for over 2,000 years blows my mind. It is a miracle. Because God is working with us sinners with all our different situations and all our different things. And you know what? God has us in the palm of his hand at the top of the hill. And we will trust him and we'll act in faith and we'll respond in faith to the needs and situations. And God will empower us. You know, maybe there's something here that needs to pray this morning and say, you know what, God? I need you to empower me to make $100,000 extra before the end of Christmas. And I'll give whatever you want of it to the church. I don't know. Let's pray in faith. Let's pray big. Let's pray bold. Let's say, hey, God, you know what? Let's see what you can do. And then we will glorify his name. Because you know what? He probably wants to put us in a position that we can't rescue ourselves from. Because he's jealous for his glory. Isn't he? He wants to receive the glory. What I love, I'm right off my notes. Anyhow, Moses comes to the Red Sea. Have you ever read that passage really close? Moses comes to the Red Sea. He's up to his knees in the water. And he says, now what, God? And God's like, well, go forward. That's exactly how it reads. You know, even up to the point where he knew God was going to do something. He didn't know what God was going to do. But God said, move forward. Go forward. I'm with you. And I'll tell you with all confidence, God is with us.
Amen.
We're going to move forward because we are a people of faith, are we not? Amen. It's not my notes. But I trust God. Because I know God brought me here on purpose. I know he brought you here on purpose, for a purpose. And it's to reach our community for his name's sake and for him to receive glory. To put us in situations that are way out of our control. Thank God. Well, speaking of that, when I think of gold, how many of you think of this guy? right? The Olympian. The guy who's searching for gold, who's fighting for gold, who has to train his body. He literally goes through a trial of his own personal discipline and a trial of being in competition against the world's best. For what? For gold. For gold. I always feel so bad for the team. I remember watching the hockey Olympics, and Canada's got gold, and they're like, ah! And then for America, they've got, I don't even know if it's zero America got, so whoever got silver, right? The faces. I mean, like, really, if you gotta think about it, you're the second best in the world! But gold. Man, you aim and you're so close. There's a trial. You know, and I think about Joseph and Mary. Why did God bring them gold? Well, they were about to go through a trial that they didn't know that they were going to go through. Mm-hmm. They were going to have to move. They were going to have to run from King Herod. How do you think they afforded to live in Egypt? How do you think they afforded to make the move to Egypt? Well, I'm sure that gold came in some handy. How did Joseph get his business starting? We know that Joseph and Mary had other kids. It wasn't that long afterwards, and they have this family feed. Well, I'm sure that gold came in handy. And God knew what they needed before they even knew they needed it, up to a year in advance. It's like, he's being born. Yeah, I better get him some gold. He'll need it on this exact date, so I don't want it to be too early. It won't be late. I'll make it right on time. How about that? Just like was last year, we had 5 Sundays in December. We were concerned about our finances. We lost 2 Sundays to snowstorms. We're like, oh, God. And God's like, I got this. There was trials that they were to experience and they needed to be sustained. And then we look at the scripture in Isaiah 41:10. This is one of my life verses. And when I go through a trial or I go through a struggle, it says, fear not, for I am. I am that I am. I am the bread of life. I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am the great I am, your God. I will strengthen you. Yes. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Where else would you want to be? Where else would you want to be? I think of Jesus. He was, at the first of his ministry, he had to go through a trial, didn't he? He was baptized, and God said, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. And right afterwards, Jesus goes into the wilderness to go through a period of trial. It says Matthew 4:1, it says, then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, just to confess, I've never done that. I've done the 24-hour famine, and that's about it. Afterward, he was hungry. I believe that maybe none of us here have experienced that kind of hunger. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread. You know, make these stones become bread. But Jesus answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. It's what he was holding on to. His sustenance, the thing that's going to save him, is not his power to change or transmogrify or whatever you want to call it, change rock matter into bread matter, but it's the words of the living God. And likewise, it says in 1 Peter 6:7, in this you greatly rejoice. Not just a Canadian, whoopee, but like a Canadian at a hockey game, whoopee, right? Greatly rejoice. Unless the other team scored, then that's a... For now, a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials. Wait, I'm supposed to greatly rejoice in this? Yes, because that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold. Check that out. God is more concerned. Check this out. God is more concerned about the state of your faith than about the state of your finances. Mm. Well, I we're probably more concerned about the state of our finances than the state of our faith. But God wants us to be concerned with the state of our faith, to rejoice when we go through trials. Why? Because gold perishes. God has a long-term view in plan here. You know, God can accelerate things and things can change fast, but there's other times where God takes it slow and says, you know what, we've got to spend some time chiseling here, chiseling out some stuff. Gold perishes. Faith is eternal. Though your faith is tested by fire, may it be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Let's be honest. There's not a single one of us here who couldn't do with a little deeper understanding of who Jesus Christ is. We would never be afraid if we truly understood Jesus. But you know what happens? We get overcome, we get overwhelmed, and we lose sight. We get our eyes off focus on who Jesus is and all his majesty. It's so easy to get distracted or just pulled aside, and we forget, calls me his child. I mean, you think it's, we don't sometimes put it in place. I mean, what if Mike Tyson, the boxer, says, Andrew, you're my child. And he meant it. I mean, don't talk to my mom about that. That didn't happen. But, you know, what if Prince Charles says to me, you know what, Andrew, you're my child. I'm going to adopt you. Oh, yeah. Sorry, Mom. Sorry, Dad. Call me the prince, right? More Harry, more William, right? No, it's not going to happen. But when we sometimes, you know, God's just not touchable enough. Sometimes we lose the ability to grasp the depth and the richness of who Jesus Christ really is. We were at a missions meeting the other day for CBM, and one of the fellows said, one of the reasons we don't give to missions as much anymore, and this is nothing but a business meeting, this is just coming off the top of my head, is that we don't see God changing lives on the local missions front. And when we don't see lives being changed for real on the local missions front, how in the world do we ever get a passion to see that happen somewhere else in the world? When was the last time you saw someone's life radically changed for Jesus Christ? If you've grown up in the church, like I have, sometimes you don't see it because all that cool stuff happened before you were born. I get to see a lot of the after effects, you know. But I also recognize that sometimes there is this life that is just radically changed in a moment and an instant. And other times, we miss that happening because God decides that it's going to actually take a little longer and it's messy. And then it's hard, maybe it's annoying, or however it is. But we need to recognize that if God's going to change someone's life, it's going to happen at God's pace, not our pace. We say, God says, it doesn't matter if you love someone that you love. I mean, God, when you get to heaven, if you've got a nice little puppy, you know, I love my puppy. God's not going, wow, that's incredible love. You love your dog. Wow. No. But if you love and give your love to someone who might not deserve it, or is really annoying, or is really messy, or is really whatever makes you uncomfortable, then God says, ooh, we got some real love here. We got some real love here. Right? And you don't have to go far. Right? Come spend some time with me and you'll see how messy I really am. Right? Spend some time with me and see how annoying I can get, right? Honestly, taking those relationships a little bit deeper. Rejoice greatly when you go through fire because God is more concerned with your faith. This precious gold. Gold has grabbed the hearts of people, hasn't it? Man, this show, the Curse of Oak Island. Tell me, how many of you have ever watched an episode of the show? Man, I want them to find gold. Anybody else? I'm like, stop teasing me and find the gold already. We're 2015. Don't we have the technology? Blow up the island. Do something. Get me that gold. I want to know what's down there. Do you know how many theories there are about how many things They even think that the Ark of the Covenant might be down there. No word of a lie. They think some Templars may have had it and taken it and hidden it down there. I'll tell you, if that's the truth, can't look at your calendars and count the time, because I'll tell you, Christ will be coming shortly, right? We don't know what's down there. But gold has gripped and claimed the lives of 6 men. Trying to find the treasure of Oak Island, this passion. I mean, you think of the gold rushes out west, and we know that, you know, there's some crazy stuff that happened out there. But gold. You seen the ads on TV, the guy paints himself all in gold sparkles, like, cash for gold! Cash for gold! I'm like, yeah, I'm not giving that to you, buddy. Metals. Gold medals, precious. Isaiah 13:12 tells us that gold was not common. It said, I will make people scarcer than pure gold, more rare than the gold of Ophir. But Jesus tells us, you know what, guys? Gold is precious. Yeah, it's valuable in the eyes of man, but, you know, the old joke goes, it's pavement in heaven. The streets are paved with gold in heaven. So don't fix your eyes on the road. Don't fix your eyes on dirt. Because that's all it is. And it rusts. The only thing that makes gold valuable is its rarity. And a heart full of faith is a rarity, unfortunately, sometimes. So Jesus says, don't lay up for yourselves, Matthew 6:19, treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. I'll finish this last verse in a second. My grandmother once told me, you know, education doesn't cost you a thing to carry around. Well, neither does faith. You can carry it with you wherever you go. Trusting your relationship with Jesus can go with you wherever you go. Just invite him into your situation. Invite him into your workplace. Invite him into your Sunday morning service before you get here. Invite him into your cooking. Because God just might say, bring Andrew cookies. Jesus says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And our heart needs to be on him. Our heart needs to be a heart of faith. And we need to trust and be ready for our soon coming King. How many of you have got caught up in stuff? I remember as a kid, I got caught up in looking for, what do they call it? Fool's gold. Well, we're playing marbles on the pavement in front of my house, and we had like a sidewalk, and you know, you're shooting the marbles, and there's a hole, it's a camera marble hole, and you're playing your games. And once in a while, a little piece of rock would chip out, and there'd be this shiny part. I'm like, Aaron, my brother, I just found gold. I run up to my mom, oh, I found gold! And she looked at me and says, no, Andrew, that's fool's gold. I said, how do you know it's fool's gold? Right, I'm like 6 or 7. She's like, because it's the sidewalk. But still, you know, you'd be at the school, you'd be at the playground, see these rocks, and the shiny part, like, it's gold, I found gold. Ah, it's fool's gold. And in some ways, not always, but in some ways, all gold is fool's gold in the end. Because it doesn't really have eternal value. It's good for the moment. It's good to be comfortable, I guess. But Jesus calls us out in Revelation 3:20. Do you remember that? The scriptures. Jesus talking to Christians. It's often been used as a means to reach out to the lost. But really, it's Jesus himself knocking on the door of the Christian and saying, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if you let me in, I will come and sup with you. I will dine with you. And this morning, as we prepare for communion, recognize that don't search for gold. Don't let your heart be worried about these other things. I mean, it's Christmas. There's not one of us who probably hasn't put something on Visa, right? Don't let your hearts be worried. Don't get caught up in this stuff. Don't get caught on gold. Don't get your eyes caught on gold. Jesus didn't get his heart on gold. He didn't even need it for the full first year of his life. But when he needed it, God provided it at the right moment. God knows it's more important for our faith and our hearts to be right with him in this Christmas season. And so I invite you to the table of the Lord this morning. Indeed, God, we believe in the one born in Bethlehem, and we give you thanks for all the gifts you've given us through him. And we praise you for his birth, for how he lived his life as a servant of your most holy will, and for how, in obedience and love, he finally gave himself over to death, even death on a cross, for our sakes, thereby opening to all people the gates of heaven and the way to eternal life. O God, we spread this table before you as Jesus commanded us to do on the night he was betrayed. Come, all you who celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ, come, you who hope in him for salvation and the forgiveness of sins. Come, those broken and beaten, tired and worn. Come, those victorious, tested and tried. Come, all who have received the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. For this is his table. Ask the deacons to come forward and prepare the table. The worship team to come forward, and let us take just a moment to prepare our hearts to receive this time of communion with our Lord and Savior.